a different platform. Before this demonetization, I was not a, I have no idea with money, anything with finance and economics, anything like that. So after the demonetization, actually, as a engineer who is involved in the resource management, some questions came to my mind. Because first question was, there was cash restrictions. Why it is like so? If you are having resource crunch, definitely you have to put restrictions. Then I was looking in the media for a couple of days. There was no amount. They were not talking about the quantity of value of this demonetized currency. Then there was no talk about when these restrictions will be removed. Then another funny thing I noticed, that there is no change for the 2000 notes. Because previously, even I get 1000 rupees from my ATM, I am having some difficulty to get a change for that one. Now it is a 2000, and I have to, the next denomination will be 100. So 2000 notes are required. Then I have not seen any 500 note anywhere. So just that forced me to look into the data. Actually, I was used to look into solid data. Basically, when I am dealing with issues, I always believe that when you are talking about somebody's data, or if you are actually looking somebody, you have to take their data and ask questions to them instead of relying on some other data. So I just went to the RBI. There I found that funny. This, you can see that this, this green light. Yeah, it is the 500 note, and this one is the 1000 notes. Totally, it will be 86.4% of the total currency was there. So I actually gone back to the RBI records. Then I found that you can see that this graph, this is a 100 rupee note. It started from, I actually look into the data. I have taken the data from 1977 to 2016. You can see that at that time it is around 50%, and it actually come down to 10%, the 100 rupee note. Meanwhile, the 500 note actually started from zero. Then it is actually introduced somewhere around 87, 88, and it has now reached around 50%. So when the demonetization happened in 77, 78, they have not taken anything. The 100 was very much in the circulation. And this time they removed the pivotal currency from this circulation. So I was looking at another data, actually, how this currency is actually, how much currency in the circulation. Because government was taking that, telling that, okay, this demonetization was there. For a long time, they were actually planning this one. And some media was telling that for more than 1 year it was there. So I was looking. The government was actually, they have taken charge sometime around May. At that time, the currency was around 12.83 lakhs. It actually increased to 14.29 on March 2005. March 2016, it is 16.42. But funny thing is that between that November period, just before November 8, the information was available on the data on November 4th. At that time, it was around 17.98 lakhs. Between March and November, the government themselves actually pushed more than 1.6 lakh crore currency into the market when they want to say that they are going for demonetization. Now, you look into the total demonetization currency. This 500 notes is around 17 plus million notes. And 1,000 is around 7 million notes. How you are going to replace this currency? That's another question. I looked into the capacities, press capacities actually. The Nasik is the oldest press in India. That can actually pull, that is the yearly capacity. They can 5,800, there was 2,820. Mysore and Salboni together, they can 16,000 million. I checked this one with because I was looking into the last 5 years data. Whether these presses are actually made, pushed currency more than this, or what is the production of? It's almost tally with around 24,000 million. What's the capacity of these presses are there? Then an RTI revelations. 8/11/2016, an RTI revealed that the government has, they are having 2.47 billion currency of 2000 notes in their stock. There is no 500 in with them. And another RTI, they revealed that they started printing these 500 notes on 23/11/2016. But funny thing is that RBI has actually put some serial numbers. We have released the 500 series note serial number before between these two days, between 23/11. If you look at their press release, they are telling that they released the notes. They only, another RTI, they are telling that they started printing only on 23/11/2006. Now, I looked into the thing. There is a problem. I told you in the beginning, there was the liquidity problem. Between 100 to 2000, you need 20 notes. Before that, there was a 1000 rupee note. Now they eliminated that one. So definitely you need, if you are putting 2000, you need more 500 actually. I am not taking that into account. I am assuming that the government is fully converting the 1000 to 2000. That means the rest, they have to print around 956 million 2000 notes, and they have to print around 17,500 notes. Totally, they have to print 18,121 notes after the demonetization, because they have a stock of around 4 lakh crore or 2000 notes with them. So I am just giving you two scenarios. These two scenarios actually after the 8/11, I am taking that the regular pattern of their printing that they are actually adopting for the last 5 years. Mysore Salboni is working two shifts, Nasik and Devas, they are working maximum. They can print maximum, these two presses can print 66.9 million notes per day. In that, if that's the case, they will take around 271 days to print all these currencies. 6th August 2017 is the date. Otherwise, you think that because Nasik and Devas, they can't push them, but Mysore and Salboni belongs to the Reserve Bank, they can go for three shifts. If three shifts is also a problem, because it is a high security printing press. You can't hire a Dick and Harry there and put them into the this as your workforce, because there is a risk involved, a security involved. This guy will go out and he will start printing himself. So the existing workforce, okay, they can ask them to work for 2 weeks or 3 weeks. Beyond that, who will work for three shifts? You have a manpower of using for only two shifts. Even then, we are assuming that itself will take another 204 days. So, yesterday I was looking into another data. So, this is since I am just currency on circulation on 4/11/2016 is around 17.977 billion. And the SBN on circulation, this is a reply given to the parliament, it is 15.44. So we can, from this we can see that the lower denomination on circulation was around 2.577 billion, the difference between these two. The latest RBI data, the RBI reveals that the currency on circulation on 31/17 is 9,500 billion. So HDN on circulation, high definition notes, high denomination notes, you reduce this 2.577 from that one, you will get it is 7.25. That is 47% of the actually, they actually demonetized 15.44. So it is 7.25. But interestingly, you look into the data RBI given in RTA. They have given, said you that it is around 4.946 billion they have printed on 8/11. So you just reduce this 7.25, and they have only pushed between 8/11 for the last 66 days after the demonetization. Between 13/17, they have only able to pump only high definition, this high denomination notes, only 2.3 billion, 2,300 billion only they have. And the remaining is 8,000. How many days? You just calculate. It's almost more than three times, around three times. It will take 180 days. I don't know. If they are having a magic wand with them, I don't know. So now the question, how I actually look into this one. I actually, when I am looking into certain things, there is annual reports of RBI. I have taken everything from 2000 onwards. I downloaded it from their website. Then there are a lot of working group reports. That is the expert reports RBI taken for their studies. Or then there is, this is the major thing, the database on Indian economy. This is a warehouse of information. The problem with that one is that plenty of information is there. You have to yourself to find that which one is suiting you, because the data is just like a sea. Then there are press release and circulars. Then there are acts and rules are there. Then I went to the finance ministry also. They are having so many committee and study reports. The latest one is the Vatal committee report. Then their gazette notifications or circulars are available there. Then this, the press, the Nasik and Devas press, actually that is Security Print Mill Company India Limited. Their annual report is available under the finance ministry. Then they are having financial inspection unit and CBCE, CBDT, all these are under there. Then I actually also went to the parliament to see the question answer. From so many years, I searched that one, and there are house panel reports also there. Then I also checked, because this is basically I collected those information from Google Scholar. I don't go for general Google search. Always look for some authentic information rather than the press report. I know the problem with the journalists. They don't have enough time, and we are not letting them to do the research also. So they are actually quoting somebody, because that is my experience when I am dealing with Mullaperiyar. Some very good journalists, they are coming with me. They are not understanding the jargons, because that's a esoteric subject. Whatever I am saying, they are producing. Sometimes they are producing, there may be 0.21G will become 2.1G. So I don't want to, I take the reports actually as a pointer only. Then I go back to these things. I have seen a lot of studies, World Bank studies, Visa, MasterCard, Fletcher School, Boston Consulting Group, and Google, McKinsey, CDFI, IIT, Mumbai. Then there are, there is another good database is Central Statistical Organization and National Crime Records Bureau. They are having a lot of information. Then I used only Excel. Many people ask me, what are the tools? Actually, Excel, I am used with Excel and this pivot table facility of Excel. I used to do my data crunching mostly. Then I think how much time remains? Okay, 5 more minutes I will take. There is a talk that everything is telling that India is having a high currency GDP ratio. We are looking into US. This is actually taken from a working report on that one. I don't have the latest one, but you can see that Japan is having around 18.1, and they are saying we are having around 30. So Thailand is also having. All these economies are actually, they are also growing economies. And what are the things actually? This is actually an exercise I have done. Because when I read this Vatal committee report, they are telling that the currency GDP ratio is 12.04%. But the source, they are not mentioning. But under that one, I was looking where they got the data. Actually, I am looking the data. The present one is around 10.86 or something like that. That's the currency with the public and the GDP at the currency market price. This I have taken from the Handbook of Statistics of Indian Economy 2015-16. This is published by RBI. It is available in there. This is from this table I created this graph. Then there is currency with the public, but maybe I thought that, okay, they may be taken that actually from the currency in circulation. If you are looking at the currency in circulation, this will only become 11 point something. It's not going to be 12.04. And it's actually, is this a factor? I was looking. Because another factor, this is for the last 5 years, RBI is not talking about, RBI is not showing this graph. There is a graph actually, this is currency versus broad money actually, currency in circulation. Actually, if you look into that one, it is getting reduced. What is broad money? Broad money is actually the currency with the public plus your savings bank account and your current bank account, it is called demand money. Then your fixed deposit, they are taking this time deposits. All together is broad money. That means the currency is less, your deposits are increasing actually. And you look, this is the position in 71-72. The currency versus broad money was around 37%. Actually 2001-2, it becomes around 17-18. So why this happened? Because we are having a lot of bagging. So people started saving on that one. Now, what is the factors affecting currency demand? Is the only thing you have to look, because everyone is telling about the currency GDP ratio. There are certain things, economic, technological, cultural and sociological factors that influence currency demand. That differ across countries. US, they are having a different type of population. Their style of using currency is different. And we are having a huge population. So there is thing, the cross-country variation, growth, inflation, interest rates, the rate of direct and indirect taxes, share of informal and underground economy in the overall economic activity influences, organization of economic activity, dominance, retail versus, all these things are actually your influencing your currency demand. Now look into the data. Actually, Vattal Committee is saying that, okay, and there is a big talk that if your cashless or the digital payments are actually increasing manifold, we are going to have huge, the cash, we will crush the cash 50%. They are telling that now it is 12.4, within 3 years they are aiming to make it 6%. But this is a study done by the Visa. Visa is having their own interest. Visa's interest is their market, they are actually cherry picking the data, and that's not their kind, they are a business people. This is their study. They are telling that if you are actually this PCE is personal consumption expenditure, that's the thing comes under the your use of debit cards, credit cards and mobile wallets. Forget about NAFT, the automatic check clearance, all those things, you forget about that one. So if it is increasing from this 4% to 36%, almost 9 times, then you can reduce the cash in circulation from 11% to 10% within 5 years. This report is available here. You can get it from Google, the accelerating the growth of digital payments in India, 5 years outlook. Vattal Committee is also cherry picking the data. They are saying that this, what they are telling, for total investment of around 60,000 crores in 5 years, India could reduce its cost of cash from 1.7 to 1. I don't know from where they are telling this. This is, they are factoring a lot of other things. But if you are looking into the printing of the currency, the storing of the currency, and the logistics all together, every year our exchequer is spending around 12,000 crores to 15,000 crores. If you are looking into the last year's data, the credit card companies itself done a business of around 4 lakh crores. Take it is 2.5%. They got a transaction fees of around 10,000 crores out of that one. And they are talking that, okay, you have a huge investment. When we are looking into the data, they are telling you that you are actually going to lose 10,000 or 15,000 crores per year. But I never find any relevance on this one. But they are telling that you could save around 70,000 crores in next 5 years. For that one, you have to invest around 60,000 crores. So in 5 years, you can 70,000. You invest 60,000 crore, you will save 70,000 crores. So the net saving is only 10,000 crores in the 5 years. Then increase in numbers, acceptance points. Now we are having only around 15 lakh POS. They want to increase as 40 lakhs. Then this will happen. And about, you want to put everything around 40.9 million households to the additional. Sorry, I forgot to that one. You have to put 40.9 million people into the financial system. Final words. Cash is there. Cash is actually, it is for the last 2,600 years, it is the dominant form of currency. It's a challenging, you have to remove the wheel and you want to fly. So there is a leapfrog you have to do. Whether the systems are in place, I don't know. choice should be left for the stakeholders, whether they want to transact with cash or digital form. Okay, I finished my presentation, and you can ask any doubts.
Thank you, James. That was a very illuminating presentation. So now we'll take a few questions from the audience. Anybody has any particular queries?
Hi, my name is Tanmay. You just mentioned in your final words that you know there are 40.9 million households to be included into the financial system. Can I know, you know, what's the source of this number? I mean, how did you come upon this number?
They are telling this is the study by the Visa. Actually, in 5 years, yeah. if you want to reduce your currency circulation from 11% to 10%, you have to add this much in between these 5 years.
Okay.
That's their data. I am not taking any other data because this data is laid by the Vattal committee. Because most of the their first chapter is cash is costly. To prove that one, they are actually using certain study reports by the fintech companies. They don't done it is a helicopter study, I can tell you that, because these people has not done anything. They don't go to the ground, and the government has not done any studies. There are study reports by RBI. One Nachiketamore report is there, and there is some study report by Chakrabarti, one working group report is there, why the currency is required. Okay, I am not against digital payments. I am a person who started using credit cards since 1994, but it's a choice of me. I will do that. It's on advantage, it's on disadvantage. But if you are telling, I will tell you one example. My chairman is a person who is using, he's a retired chief engineer. He's using internet, I think, since 1996 or 1980. He's conversing with me on emails. But he don't have an ATM card. He's afraid to use that one. He's thinking that it is having some security problem. Sometimes he's having his own mortal fear about that one. Last day also, he want to buy something online. He asked me to do something, and he will give me the money. That's the problem with that. That's the mental block of a person who is a chief engineer, who served as a chief engineer, and very educated person. Then you can think about the people, the rural population, how this is, they are going to adapt to this technology. Very good. You can, digital transactions will help the government to an extent. You ask one question, but I am having on that one, your question, 40.9 household. Okay, there we are talking about this Prime Minister's JDY, Prime Minister Jandan Yojana. But before that, it started actually. It started, financial inclusion was there. There was a Vision 2018 is there. We are having an act, Payment and Settlement Act, started in 2007. We are looking into before the new government comes, around 23 crore people were already, they are having basic this bank accounts. The problem with this one, I'm seeing that one, because now a lot of people are actually asked how the money comes to their account. There is no ceiling actually. Okay, if you are investing more than 50,000, otherwise if somebody is putting money in your account with the connivance of the bank manager, you don't know. You don't know. Somebody can invest the money on that one. They can put before the demonetization. If somebody knows, I'm making some hypothetical thing. Somebody was actually investing 40,000. Above 50,000 only, you have to show your PAN card and other things. Otherwise, you can deposit there. The bank officers can give the money next day. They can deposit and they can withdraw. Who is going to know that? Second thing is that 2-3 days back, I am surprised. I got an SMS from my bank. They told that some money in your salary was seeped into a recurring deposit. I was totally surprised. Without my permission, they are doing that one. I went to the branch. I asked, no, this is this is a corporate salary account. We are going to give you some more 2.5% interest, and these are the some frills. They are telling that these are available, but I told, fine, everything is fine. But when you are actually shifting my SB account to a recurring deposit account or a high the interest earning account, you should take my permission. No, we are having some arrangement with my parent organization, KICB. I told that is between you and them. That is only, they are only putting money in my account, but the account belongs to me. And you are not taking permission. That happens to a person like me. you can see that how it is going to happen to others.
Yeah.
Thank you. Question from Mr. Sridhar.
Mike.
This is conceptually, in terms of economic concepts, cash to GDP as a cross-country comparison is flawed because the structure of GDP in different economies are different. Like for instance in India, we have 90% of employment in India is in informal activities. That is one. Secondly, the ticket size of transactions in such an economy would be very small. It goes with informality that the ticket sizes would be very small. This is one. Secondly, the cultural factors and so on that you mentioned, even by these comparisons, Russia, Switzerland, which don't figure in your table, even Singapore comes pretty close to India. These are all have high cash prevalence in transactions. Now, to say that these are wrong and these are bad is flawed, you know. So this cash to GDP is deeply flawed, and quite apart from the fact that you distinguish between the broad money and the narrow money thing, this cash to GDP is a very serious anomaly. It cannot be used in making comparisons across countries.
Sure, just like that. Asking you that the Americans are wearing suits, you have to wear suits every day. You can't tell that. We have our own sari. You can't tell that the people to wear that one because you are showing the US and telling the people that, okay, tomorrow onwards you have to wear a top and midi. Just like that. They are actually comparing apples with oranges. And this is, they are giving an impression that this is the only factor. The currency with this GDP ratio is the only factor governing the currency you are actually recovering the economy. Because your GDP is actually, this currency is the fuel actually driving the economy. You are taking that out, we will see in the coming days how much our economy is crushed, the rural and the retail economy. They can't, if even then, now you are looking into the things, government themselves, I don't give any data, I only looked into the November data published by the RBI, that's the only fully data on the after the demonetization, the December data will come the end of this month. January 31st only we will get. In that one, every other digital payment gone down. Credit card, if you are looking into the credit card, except the debit card use in POS, it has increased, but how much? It's increased around 30%. That's all. And this is a forced one because you have no choice. Once you have a choice, you will decide what you will do. That's you have to left with the people, you have to make your digital payments attractive. Definitely people will adapt slowly. That will be a choice left with me or you. You can't tell that I will remove cash, I will Monday morning I can bring this one.
Yeah, can we take some more? We'll just take some more questions. That lady, oh sorry, and then I'll come to you.
Hi, this is Gangadhar. So when we're talking about digital currency, you know, it makes me think about what happened in the US with, you know, their media being sort of open to being manipulated from outside. I'm wondering how, you know, like an external player can influence our financial economy by the fact that, you know, everything is digital. I mean, a simple way can be knock off the telecom providers and then suddenly you can't transact, right? So that already happens when we have natural disasters, you know, calamities.
Otherwise,
like that.
Government
so
will force themselves also.
Sorry?
Otherwise, government is themselves shutting down. If you are in Manipur or Kashmir, they are shutting down the internet services.
Right. So just to add on, like from your point itself, India has the max number of internet shutdowns anywhere in the world.
Hmm.
I think in 1 year, 37 instances of internet shutdowns happened in India for various reasons. And from the slightly ludicrous, like exams are happening, to serious law and order issues, we don't need foreign intervention. I think in India itself, we've had 37 internet shutdowns.
Right. So, so where I'm going with this is, A, it increases the attack vectors on the country itself from external entities. Then B, me as a normal citizen, what can I do to protect myself in case of, let's say there is a hurricane coming and I know that it's coming. So what do? Do I hoard up cash at that point? Like hoarding up on food and water and everything. So, has anybody thought about it, or did you see anything in the Watal report? I'm just curious about that.
You talk about natural calamities. I'm very much into disaster management for past several years. You can see that only the natural calamity you can actually predict is the cyclone. Before 7 days, you will get a warning time. You don't have a warning time for your earthquake. You don't have a warning time for a few hours for to happen a storm, just like happened in that Mumbai and other places, that Rishikesh and other places. So, how this digital economy is going to help you, we don't know. The government actually in the beginning, they say about cashless, but they corrected themselves because none of the documents, neither this Visa, MasterCard, nobody is using that word cashless. They always use the term less cash. After some days, government, because they are changing that one. Now looking into the another aspect, because anybody is having any question, I'll tell.
There was one more question there.
Hi, my name is Mangalam. Am I audible? So my question is that a significant part of the narrative primarily focuses on the retail transactions and the purchasing power and the like, right? So when you talk about someone's having a choice about whether to use cash versus digital, I still think at that point it is personal choice. But given that a significant amount of our country is still unbanked, they don't have bank accounts, individual bank accounts, even the Jandan Yojana, I don't think they're necessarily transacting, or access to it is very limited. And a significant informal sector, right, the unorganized sector, they continue to get paid wages as cash.
Yeah.
That actually puts them at significant risk because, it's just not accounted, and the employer actually has way more control and power and privilege. So I find that the point of view of just looking at retail transactions and purchasing power is sort of one-sided because, the urban population has the luxury of possibly having multiple bank accounts and multiple digital transactions, the facility of it, but not looking at the rural sector and just looking at it from this one-sided point that, but they get to transact in cash and we're taking away that liberty without looking at this other aspect that, you're limiting how they can get their wages and actually taking away the control from these power centers. Isn't that like another perspective we should even be looking at?
Yeah, we are not looking them. We are actually because there is one problem is also there. Basically, the media is, rather than the print is also now emulating the electronic media. Very few print journalists are actually going into depth. Electronic media is only concentrated on the urban centers. But they are actually projecting the urban center information. We are talking in Twitter. We are actually watching the news, prime time news. They are only concentrating on this urban population. And okay, it is business-wise also. They are also looking at the digital payments. If these people are actually there, those people, they know that the rural population is not going to adopt digital anytime soon. But they are looking that if they can actually take some urban population into this digital, that's their business. The business is, you see that last year they have done 4 lakh crore credit and debit cards. If it is multiplying twice, their revenues actually doubling. So they are actually looking into that one. These people are actually becoming guinea pigs, the rural people actually. I can know one example from my family. My uncle is a contractor. He is employing around 50 Bengalis, but he stopped the work because they want the money in cash. So there was no cash. He told them that once the situation normalizes, you can come back. So they just like that, the money is stopped. Then another narrative is they are telling that 15.44 lakh crore is issued. Only 50% will come back. The rest will be black money and fake currency. One question, this fake currency is not accounted in the 15.44 lakhs. There will be black money, a component is stored in the cash, but that is only fool people. Most of the people who are actually making the cash money, they will divert it to some other form. Fake currency, if you are having more than 5 numbers of fake currency, the bank will forced to report, they are forced to file an FIR. So it happens, you look into the data, there is no, we don't get any fake currency. Only information actually released by is the State Bank of Travancore, Kerala. The amount of fake currency they got trapped in the entire demonetization process is 0.000, 3 zeros and 7%. Otherwise, last year itself, Reserve Bank and the other banking system, they got 0.0018% fake currency detected in their system annually. They got that.
So thank you very much, Mr. Wilson. We had a very entertaining and very interesting discussion.